From the corner of 16th and Peachtree Street, right next to the High Museum of Art in Midtown Atlanta, welcome to the First Presbyterian Church. My name is Tony Sundermeyer, the senior pastor, and I want to thank you for watching today's broadcast. Now, I invite you to join in the worship of God.
Please join me in our scripture reading of Psalm 138. I give you thanks, O Lord, with my whole heart. Before the gods, I sing your praise. I bow down toward your holy temple and give thanks to your name for your steadfast love and your faithfulness. For you have exalted your name and your word above everything. On the day I called, you answered me. You increased my strength of soul. All the kings of the earth shall praise you, O Lord, for they have heard the words of your mouth. They shall sing the ways of the Lord, for great is the glory of the Lord. For though the Lord is high, he regards the lowly, but the haughty he perceives from far away. Though I walk in the midst of trouble, you preserve me against the wrath of my enemies. You stretch out your hand, and your right hand delivers me. The Lord will fulfill his purpose for me. Your steadfast love, O Lord, endures forever. Do not forsake the word of your hands. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Addison. Our second text comes from the Gospel of Matthew, the 16th chapter, verses 13 through 20. Continue to listen to God's word to you and to me. Now, when Jesus came into the district of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, "Who do people say that the Son of Man is?" And they said, "Some say John the Baptist, but others Elijah, and still others Jeremiah or one of the prophets." And Jesus said to them, "But who do you say that I am?" Simon Peter answered, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." And Jesus answered him, "Blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father in heaven. And I tell you, you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades will not prevail against it. I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven." Then Jesus sternly ordered the disciples not to tell anyone that he was the Christ. Friends, this too is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Would you join me in prayer? Lord, break open your word afresh to us this day so that we would be different people than those who tuned into this worship experience. That we would be different people who are ready to make a decision for you, even in the midst of uncertainty, even in the midst of struggle, that you, by your power and by your word, would form in us the courage to decide on you, Jesus the Christ. It's in his name that we pray. Amen. Well, the concept of decision fatigue has become quite in vogue in these pandemic days. Psychologically speaking, decision fatigue describes how the quality of our decisions can actually deteriorate when we are required to make serial choices one choice on top of another choice on top of another choice on top of another choice. In other words, when we are confronted with dilemmas and choices that pile up on each other, our standards, our core principles, and even our discipline to not make impulse decisions can all become undercut and impaired. When we are experiencing decision fatigue, we're prone to what some psychologists and social scientists call decision avoidance. And what happens when we experience decision avoidance is that we wind up postponing decisions. We wind up not taking action in the moment. We may not take the action that the moment actually requires. Or sometimes in decision avoidance, we will simply make the status quo choice. The status quo choice is the choice that everybody expects us to make. It's the choice that we ourselves expect to make. An often used illustration of how this all works relates to parole boards. Now, statistically speaking, an incarcerated person actually has a higher chance of being granted parole the earlier in the day their parole hearing actually takes place. In fact, multiple studies have shown that a person scheduled to go before the parole board early in the docket is more likely to receive parole than a person who committed the same exact crime, who has already served the same sentence, but finds themselves at the bottom of the agenda for the day. The person who goes earlier has a higher chance of receiving parole than the person who goes later. You see, as case after case is reviewed, the board experiences decision fatigue, which leads to decision avoidance, which often then produces the default choice. And the default choice in this case is not to grant parole, or what they wind up doing is simply postponing those hearings to another date on the calendar. Now, decision fatigue is something I think that impacts all of us. I think decision avoidance is something that impacts us even now in these pandemic days. We not only have our normal personal and professional decisions in front of us, not only those things that are routine, those things that are common that we have to decide on week to week, month to month, year to year, but in this age of coronavirus, we also have stacks of new requirements that have been placed upon us, new concerns, new dilemmas, new decisions that have to be made. Decisions about school, decisions about college, decisions about childcare, decisions about what we can do in the church and on this campus, decisions about visiting family, decisions about where we can go if we find ourselves experiencing homelessness or we find ourselves living in poverty. Where can we go when so many services have been shuttered and closed? We've got decisions about politics. We've got decisions about protests. We've got decisions about our employment. We've got decisions about whether we should still live in the place we are living. We've got decisions about our safety and the safety of our family and our friends. We have decisions about how we're going to take care of each other, how we're going to take care of ourselves spiritually, emotionally, physically, and mentally. And my assumption this morning is that all of us participating in this broadcast, all of us participating in worship, we actually want to make the right choices. We want to make the right decisions. We want to be faithful. We want to make God-fearing choices. And we're exhausted. We're overwhelmed by all the decisions that still remain in front of us. Yes, I suspect that many of us have decision fatigue. I suspect that many of us are experiencing forms of decision avoidance in these days. And I raise all these thoughts at the outset of this sermon because I am keenly interested, I am really interested in how these words from Matthew chapter 16 land in the mind and the heart of those who are experiencing decision fatigue. I'm interested in how these words from Matthew 16 land in people's lives who are experiencing some measure of decision avoidance. Because embedded in this text, at core in this text, is an invitation to decide. In this text, a decision needs to be made. Who do you say that I am? Not somebody else. It's not a decision for somebody else. It's not a choice for somebody else. But who do you say that I am? What's your decision on this question? How will you answer? In the text itself, it is the one known as Peter, the rock, Petra, his name, who responds with the first answer. You are the Christ. You are the Son of God. And let us pay close attention to Peter's words here because they are so much more than a verbal affirmation of faith. They're so much more than mental or theological gymnastics. Peter is doing something more here than making a theological statement. The response that Peter gives will shape his life and his death. Anytime someone answers this question, regardless of how they answer it, their life will be changed. How they decide on Jesus Christ will change the outcomes of their life, whether we follow him or not, whether we give our lives over to his mission of love and reconciliation or not. What we decide about this fundamental, what I would call crisis question, who do you say that I am, will shape every other decision that's in front of us. This section in Matthew really is an inflection point for his gospel telling. It's really a turning point because if Jesus really is the Messiah, if he really is the Son of God, then it stands to reason that this one must be followed. Even if it takes the disciples, even if it takes us into discomfort, and it will take us into discomfort, even if it takes us into the hard truth, and it will take us into the hard truth about our lives and about our world, even if it takes us to the precipice of the darkness, to the precipice of the cross, to the precipice of the stone-sealed tomb. You see, when Peter confesses that Jesus Christ is Lord, that he is Messiah, that he is the Son of God, what Peter is actually doing is making a decision on how he's going to live and who it is that he will follow. Of course, for those of us who know the back part of Peter's story, we know that he is going to do that imperfectly. And in his imperfection, we see ourselves. We know what it's like to deny. We know what it's like to forget. We know what it's like to wander in times of fear and in times of anxiety, in times of feeling overwhelmed. Sometimes it's just simply easier to choose the road less traveled. When we have decision fatigue, we sometimes choose the easier way. We oftentimes, when we're faced with decision fatigue, choose the status quo of what I would call self-centeredness. The status quo of self-centeredness is sort of our human sinful default. So when we have these moments of decision fatigue and decision avoidance, it's so common for us to turn inward. I think that's what happened with Peter. For those who don't know that part of his story, He follows Jesus as he's arrested to just outside where his trial, his mock trial was taking place, and he's being tortured and persecuted, and Peter is outside of that courtroom warming himself by the fire when someone asks, "Are you part of his crew? Are you one of the Jesus followers?" And Peter denies him no less than 3 times, and he hangs his head in shame. We may have made a decision for Christ. We may have decided on Christ, but that doesn't mean that we follow him perfectly. Far from it. We know what it's like to warm ourselves by the fire and to deny him. But friends, here is the good news. Here's the good news of the story of the gospel of Jesus Christ, that grace abounds. Grace abounds, and God's grace is sufficient for us to continue to follow Christ on the way. Last year, I heard a story from a friend of mine. His son was a junior in high school, and he was starting the first day of school. He had just gotten his license the day before. And his father, before he left for school, he gave him his own set of car keys to the car. And the boy beamed with pride. He took the keys and he drove off to school. Well, a week into it, the father got a call from his son. After noontime, his son would be on his way home from school. "Dad, I got in a little accident. It was just a fender bender. No one was injured, but it was the boy's fault." And if you've ever been in that situation, maybe you remember what it was like to be in your first accident. You say to yourself, "I'm never going to drive again. I'm just going to have my parents take me everywhere." Fear and anxiety and worry can creep in, and it can paralyze you to the point where you don't want to keep driving. Well, the very next morning, as the boy came down the stairs, his dad was waiting for him at the front door, holding the set of car keys he had given him a week earlier. He asked him to open his hand, and the father put the keys into his son's palm and said, "I'll see you when you get home from school." And in that simple, simple symbolic gesture, letting his son know that despite the accident, he still wants him to drive. He still wants him to head out. He still wants him to go. Friends, despite our sin, despite our fender benders, despite our infractions, despite our wandering, our denials, despite our choosing the status quo of self-centeredness, despite of missing the mark of Jesus so often, we are forgiven. Grace abounds. Peter's story. He makes the confession. He denies Jesus. But then after the resurrection, he finds himself with the other disciples on a rocky beach by the Sea of Galilee when Jesus appears. And he calls Peter over to him and says, "Peter, do you love me?" 3 times he does it. And he gives him an opportunity to make amends. And he says, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." And then Jesus says, "Feed my sheep, feed my lambs." In other words, "Peter, you still have the keys to the kingdom. You remember when I told you back when you made the confession of me that you would have the keys to the kingdom? You still have them. I haven't taken them from you. I've chosen you for this work." And friends, may we see ourselves in the character of Peter. May we see ourselves as ones who still hold the keys to the reign of God, that we're accepted and forgiven, and that God wants us to continue to follow Christ along the way. About a year ago, I actually stood on that rocky beach by the Sea of Galilee. There's a statue, a bronze statue of Peter looking up to Jesus, and Jesus sharing this grace, sharing this forgiveness. And I remember taking off my shoes and my socks, and I walked into the water just to the edge of the sea. And what came over me in that moment was something that I've rarely experienced. It was a transcendent spiritual moment where the weight of grace came upon me. where I knew no matter where I would go, how I would fall, how I would fail, that I'm accepted, that I'm loved, that I still have the keys to the reign of God. And my hope and prayer above everything else on this day, if you don't remember anything else from this sermon, remember this, that you are loved, that you still have the keys to the kingdom, that you and I are forgiven. You see, to confess Jesus as the Messiah, to confess Jesus as the Son of God, is not just saying that you're going to go all the way and follow Jesus, but it's also receiving the acceptance and grace when you find yourself wandering. Maybe it's for a day, maybe it's for a decision, maybe it's for a season, maybe it's been a very long time. But God's grace is sufficient to bring you back to the way. So two things we learn about this confession. Number one, when we make it, what we're saying is we're making a decision to follow Jesus no matter where that goes. And number two, when we go astray, we're making the decision to accept that we are accepted, to accept Christ's grace. But it also means when we make this decision that we are going to be part of the family of God. We're making a choice saying we're going to be part of the body of Christ. In other words, we're going to be part of the church. You know, the word church, in the Greek, it's ekklesia. That word, ekklesia, appears for the very first time in the Bible in this particular text from Matthew 16. The word for church only occurs three times across Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, all in Matthew. It occurs another 100-plus times in the rest of the canon of the New Testament. I've been thinking a lot about ekklesia. I've been thinking a lot about the church. Not doing church, not going to church, but what it means to actually be the church, to be the body of Christ, because it is exceptionally challenging in these pandemic days to be the body of Christ. When so much of our being church is happening remotely, when so much of it's been interrupted, when so much of it is in driveways or on emails or telephone calls or text messages or socially distanced gatherings, it has been exceptionally difficult to be the church. I also think about all that's going on in the world and how much I miss being face to face to work out our faith in fear and trembling, to apply our theology and our life together to the pressing matters of our time, whether they be political, cultural, or social. And we can't do that work together. We can't discern together. We're unable to come together and hold hands and pray through these trying times for God's wisdom and discernment. And with our decision fatigue, this is how I want to connect it. With our decision fatigue, it is really, really easy to default to the status quo of self-centeredness. It's so easy to withdraw from that which is available to us, to not pray for one another, to not tune into the live stream, to not reach out with an email or a phone call or a text message, to not participate in an online Bible study, to not give financially like we have given in the past, to not tend to the health of our faith in these trying times. The decision to confess Jesus to be the Christ is a decision to follow him all the way. It's a decision to receive grace and God's acceptance when we stray from the path, but it is also a decision to be the church, no matter what hour it is, no matter what time it is, no matter if this sanctuary is totally full or if it's empty. Now is the time to choose to decide for Jesus, to be his body in and for the world. It's a decision to claim your place and my place at the table, to claim the Holy Spirit's power to lead us through these days. Last Sunday afternoon, we received word that one of our community ministry staff members tested positive for COVID-19. And thankfully, they had very minor symptoms that have all subsided, and they are, by all accounts, on the way to recovery. Of course, when we received this news, we immediately went into protocol mode, and we started calling all of the staff members within a discrete period of time that had interaction with this particular staff member. We decided to call, we wanted to call all of those staff members, all of the volunteers, and tell as many guests and those we provide services for, to tell all of them that this person had tested positive for COVID. And certainly when we're on campus, we're wearing masks and we're standing 6 feet apart, practicing social distance, but we wanted to make sure that everybody knew the situation. As many of you know, we have not closed community ministries. They are far from closed. They are very much open. We are serving over 1,000 people every month with stimulus check applications. We've just come through the tax season and have prepared taxes with people. We continue to do ID procurement. Our food pantry is busier than ever with so many people experiencing job loss and are relying on that pantry. We continue to do mail service and we continue to provide 4 meals during the week. We also obviously have kept our Women's Transformation Center open, which is currently housing 8 women. We've continued these ministries. We've been diligent and we've practiced the right protocols with mask wearing and social distancing. But we still wanted to engage these protocols and let everybody know. And so we were calling them and we were telling them what was next. And our protocols say that if someone comes into contact within a discrete period of time, even if they're masked, even if they're keeping social distance, that they have to quarantine, that they can't come back to work, they can't come back to the campus until they have a negative COVID-19 test. So we let everybody know that. That was one challenge on Sunday night. The other challenge was we were going to be open on Monday, but we had all of our core volunteers and our staff quarantined. So some of us began to make more phone calls and send out more emails. And by 1 p.m. on Monday, when we opened the doors for community ministries in Fifield Hall, we had all the volunteers we needed to process mail, and we had all the volunteers to prepare food and to share it. See, church members and staff who are not a part of community ministries, they all stepped up and they stepped in. They made choices with all the other decisions that were in front of them. They made choices to be the church, to show up as the body of Christ. And if that wasn't inspiration enough, if that wasn't moving enough, I found out that every one of our staff members, every single one of those core volunteers who we called on Sunday night had gone and gotten a COVID-19 test by noon, all of them by noon on Monday. They found out Sunday night, and by noon on Monday, everybody was tested. Of course, they wanted to know about their health, but I think there was something else deep inside of them, much deeper at play. To a person, they wanted to be back. They wanted to be the church. And so they made the effort to get tested as soon as they could. And you're not going to believe this. It really could be a miracle. Every person that had to get a test got their results back by Wednesday early afternoon. So that all of them, as they came back with their digital copies of COVID-19 negative tests, all of them came back to serve on Wednesday. I'm inspired by that desire. I'm inspired by their desire to be the church because I'm tired. And I know you are too. I know you're feeling overwhelmed. I know there's decision upon decision upon decision to be made. But in this moment as Christians, may we decide on Jesus Christ. May we decide to follow him no matter where he leads us. May we decide to receive his grace. May we decide that we are accepted and have the keys to the reign of God. And may we decide to be the church even in this difficult hour, even in these days, to continue the work of the kingdom. Friends, in these days of fatigue, there is a temptation for decision avoidance. There is a temptation to default to the status quo of self-centeredness. May we receive God's grace to make a different choice, to make a different decision, to say yes to Jesus Christ, to follow him, to accept his grace, and to be his church. May it be so for the sake of the gospel and the sake of the world. Amen.
Thank you for watching today's broadcast. For more video content, I'd encourage you to visit our website, firstpressatl.org. We'd love to see you here sometime at the corner of 16th and Peachtree Street to join us for worship. Thanks again for watching.